गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट, दिस इज़ द सेवेंथ लेक्चर ऑफ योर पेट्रोलियम रिफाइनरी एंड पेट्रोकेमिकल्स। टुडे द टॉपिक इज़ ऑन सॉल्वेंट एक्सट्रैक्शन एंड सॉल्वेंट डीवैक्सिंग, विच इज़ यूज आफ्टर वट एवर द प्रोडक्ट, हेवियर प्रोडक्ट इज गोज टू द वैक्यूम डिस्टिलेशन यूनिट। आफ्टर द वैक्यूम डिस्टिलेशन यूनिट इट हैज़ टू पास थ्रू सेवरल ट्रीटमेंट प्रोसेसेस लाइक प्रोपेन डीएसफॉल्टिंग प्रोसेस, सॉल्वेंट एक्सट्रैक्शन, सॉल्वेंट डीवैक्सिंग। Okay, so today we will discuss the solvent extraction and the solvent dewaxing process. Now, the solvent extraction process, which is used mainly to remove aromatics and the other impurities from lube and grease stocks. Okay, so solvent extraction is used generally to remove aromatics and the other impurities from the lube and grease stocks, and this feedstock is dried and then contacted with the solvent, because as it is the solvent extraction, this has to treat, means that feedstock need to treat with the solvent by counter current method or in a rotating disc extraction unit. This is a special type of extraction unit where the centrifugal force act as a the main driving force. So there counter current or the rotating disc extraction unit is used for the solvent extraction method. So the feedstock may, first the feedstock is dried, then contacted with the solvent, then it the operations will going on in the unit, the extraction unit, and this solvent is separated from the product stream by heating, evaporation or fractionation. Now, remaining traces of the solvents are removed from the raffinate by steam stripping or flashing system. Now, electrostatic precipitator may be used to enhance the separation of inorganic compounds. Electrostatic precipitator may be used to enhance the separation of inorganic compounds, and this solvent is then regenerated and recycled. So we use the solvent extraction mainly to remove the impurities and the other impurities and the aromatics from the lube and the grease stocks. Okay, now whatever the feed is used for the solvent extraction, it is first dried, then contacted with the solvent in a counter current method in a rotating disc extraction unit, and then in the extraction unit the solvent is separated from the product by which process? By heating, evaporation or fractionation. And whatever the remaining traces of solvents are present, that is removed from the raffinate by steam stripping or flashing process. Okay, so whatever the traces amount of solvent are present in the product, it has to remove by steam stripping or flashing process. And electrostatic precipitators may be used to enhance the separation of inorganic compounds, and then this solvent, whatever the solvent we use to regenerate it by stripping process, it is then reused or recycled. So today phenol, furfural and krasylic acid are used as solvents. Okay, phenol, furfural and krasylic acid are used as a solvents for the solvent extraction process. But in the past, some refineries installed the Edelian process, in which the solvent is liquid sulfur dioxide. In that Edelian process, where the solvent is liquid sulfur dioxide, but as there is a solvent is liquid sulfur dioxide, if some amount of this liquid sulfur dioxide is present in the product, then means after emission of this product by gases or by through effluent, it may be hazardous to the environment. So in this process, with this Edelian process, the sulfur dioxide, which is used as a solvent, it is hazardous and has a potential risk and to the environment and which is very undesirable. Okay. So chlorinated ethers and nitrobenzene is used. Okay. Chlorinated ethers and nitrobenzenes have been used. So here we can see the first feed is going to the rotating disc extractor. Feed is going to the rotating disc extractor from the bottom. Okay. Now these are the rotating disc, rotating shaft attached with a disc. Okay. Now according to the centrifugal motion, so the lighter part will go at the outside of this shell, and the heavier one will remain at the center of this shaft. So whatever the extract or the solvent, it then from the extra rotating disc extractor, it goes to the heater or the furnace. Then again it has to send in the solvent evaporator, where the solvent is recovered. Okay. Solvent is recovered, and then again we use that solvent in this rotating disc extractor, and again from the top product of this rotating disc extraction unit, these also contain some solvent. So this also has to pass through the heater to raise the temperature. Then again it has to pass through the solvent evaporator, where we again recycled or the regenerate that solvent and reuse it in the rotating disc solvent extraction part. Okay. So next is the solvent is separated from the product stream by heating, evaporation or fractionation. Okay. Heating, evaporation and fractionation, and residual trace amounts are subsequently removed from the raffinate by steam stripping or vacuum flashing. So whatever the traces amounts will present, it has to remove from the raffinate by steam stripping process or vacuum flashing process. Now as I mentioned earlier also, electric precipitator may be used for the separation of the inorganic compounds, and the solvent is regenerated and reused in the process. And the most widely used solvents are phenol, furfural, crassulic acid, and other solvents less frequently used, which is liquid sulfur dioxide, nitrobenzene and 2,2 dichloroethyl ether. So as I mentioned that the liquid sulfur dioxide, if it is used as a solvent, if some amount of that materials will present in the product after emission of this, it will be hazardous for the environment. So and then the nitrobenzene and also the 2,2 dichloroethyl ether, which is very frequently used as a solvent in the solvent extraction process. Then the selection of specific process and the chemical agents depends on the nature of the feedstocks being treated and contaminants presence and the finished product requirement. Okay. So your specific process, the selection of the specific process and the chemical agents, it depends on which parameters, means whatever the specific your process, means whatever the feedstocks are being treated, what are the contaminants present in your feedstocks, and what are the finished products you required. Based on these three parameters, your process has been selected, and your chemical agents also depends on these parameters. Now the dewaxing process. Okay, so dewaxing means the waxy material will remove out. The straight chain and slightly branch chain paraffinic compounds tend to crystallize. Okay, the straight chain paraffin or the slightly branched paraffinic compounds tend to crystallize under ordinary temperature conditions. Then at low temperatures such as minus 20 degree centigrade, the oil needs to be in the liquid state in the engine crankcase. Okay, we required that oil need to liquid state at lower temperatures such as minus 20 degree centigrade, but for the presence of the straight chain and the slightly branched and paraffinic compounds, it tends to crystallize, and then it will choke the flow process. It choke the piping line. It hampers the flow through the pipeline. Okay, so this dewaxing should be done. So at low temperatures, such as minus 20 degrees centigrade, the oil needs to be in a liquid state in the engine crankcase. So if crystallize or solidify, it will cause flow problem. So it is not always carried out for preparing lube oil stock. Okay, so it is not always carried out for preparing lube oil stock. So the dewaxing unit is required to lower the cloud point and pour point. Okay, so remember this point: the dewaxing unit is required to lower the cloud and pour points, because to smoothen the flow process. Because if any waxy materials will present in the oil, so at the lower temperature, it has the tendency to crystallize. If it crystallize, then it will cause the flow problems of the oil. Okay, then the engine will not working. So the dewaxing unit is required to lower the cloud point and the pour point of the oil by eliminating the compounds of that straight chain or the straight branch paraffinic compounds. Okay, that crystallize and at relatively higher temperature. Although the cold settling pressure filtration process and the centrifuge dewaxing process have for the most part been replaced by solvent dewaxing. Okay, so we can replace that the solvent dewaxing process by settling pressure filtration process, cold settling pressure filtration process, and the centrifuge dewaxing process. Okay, so this is the older process are still used to a limited degree. Then the solvent dewaxing, the solvent reduces the viscosity of the oil. The solvent dewaxing reduces the viscosity of the oil and facilitate in pumping and filtration. This the most common dewaxing process is based on crystallization. The most common dewaxing process is based on crystallization with a solvent that modifies the condition of thermodynamic equilibrium solely by its presence in the liquid. Okay, now the ideal solvent should dissolve the oil and precipitate all the wax. So ideal solvent which will dissolve the oil and precipitate all the wax. So additionally, in precipitating, the wax crystal structure should be loose so that the oil can be filtered through the wax. Okay, so additionally, in precipitating, the wax crystal structure should be loose so that the oil can be filtered through the wax. Now, what are the solvents used in the solvent dewaxing process? Mainly the mixtures of methyl ether ketone MEK and toluene is used as a solvent. Another is methyl isobutyl ketone MIBK. Methyl isobutyl ketone is used as a solvent. Some are dichloromethane, some are trichloroethylene, propane, mixture of ethylene chloride and benzene, and mixture of acetone and benzene. These are used as a solvents in the solvent dewaxing process. So MEK, which is methyl ethyl ketone, it displays low solvent power for paraffinic compounds. Okay, it has low solvent power for paraffinic compounds, but toluene has excellent solvent power for base stocks. The toluene has excellent solvent power for the base stocks, and the proportions in the mixture of these two solvents can be optimized. Now, one is having low solvent power for the paraffinic compounds, but the toluene has the excellent solvent power for the base stocks, but MEK has a good selectivity. So proportionate of these two, MEK and the toluene, these mixtures can be optimized, and after optimizing it can be used as a good solvent for the solvent dewaxing process. So there are two principal solvents used generally in solvent dewaxing process. Another is propane and ketone. Okay, propane and ketone. So two principal solvents used in the solvent dewaxing process, which is propane and ketone. And the dichloroethane methyl is also used in some other countries. The ketone process use either a mixture of methyl ethyl ketone with methyl isobutyl ketone or MEK with toluene. These solvents act as a diluent for higher molecular weight oil fractions. These solvents act as a diluent, okay, for the higher molecular weight oil fractions to reduce the viscosity of the mixture and provide sufficient liquid volume to permit pumping and filtering. Okay, so this solvent is used as a diluent. After using it as a diluent, it reduces the viscosity of the mixture so that it provides sufficient liquid volume to permit pumping and filtering the process. So the process operations for both solvent process are similar but differ in the equipment which is used in the chilling and the solvent recovery portions of the process. Okay. So here we can see one simplified dewaxing process where feed is entered through a steam heater, then a heat exchanger through a heat exchanger, then the chiller, then again some rotary filter. It goes through the heater, then from the heater it goes to the slack wax evaporator. Okay, and from this rotary filter, one part goes through the heat exchanger and then again through the heater and dewaxed oil evaporator. Okay, so from this evaporator we get the dewaxed oil, and from this evaporator, in the slack wax evaporator, we get the stack wax. Okay, so we are using steam heater, heat exchanger, again chiller and rotary filter, and then the two part, one part goes through the heater in the slack wax evaporator where the stack wax is separated, and whatever the solvent is produced, it goes to the, again it goes to and recycle and regenerate it and again used as a wash solvent in the rotary filter. And another part of this rotary filter, it goes through the heat exchanger and then the heater, it go to the evaporator, and where the dewaxed oil is separated out. And here also some solvents from the top is recovered and recycled to the wash as a wash solvent in the rotary filter, or some portions as used as a makeup solvent with the feed. Okay. Now simplified dewaxing processes. This is the contacting the solvent with the oil. Okay, as is the solvent dewaxing process, so there has to be the contact with the solvent with the oil, and the crystallization in the presence of the solvent process, and the crystallization is done in the presence of the solvent, and the filtration is to remove wax from the dewaxed oil, and the separation of the solvent from the dewaxed oil and the wax is by distillation. So the separation, so first one is the contact with the solvent and the oil, then after that the crystallization process to make the waxy material crystallize. Okay, so crystallization in the presence of solvent, then whatever the crystallization process is done, so then we need to filter it to remove the waxy compounds from that dewaxed oil. So the filtration process, then the filtration process is come to remove the wax from the dewaxed oil, and then again the separation of the solvent from the de-waxed oil, and the wax is done by distillation process. So here the feedstock is mixed first with the solvent such as mixture of MEK, methyl ethyl ketone, and the toluene. Then this mixture is heated to make a mixed of oil and solvent. Then the mixture is heated to make a mixed of oil and solvent, and then the mixture is then cooled and chilled in heat exchanger and chiller system. This chiller is usually a refrigeration system operating at propane, and the mixtures of crystals and oils and solvents flows to the rotary filter. Mixture of crystals, oil and solvents flows to the rotary filters, where cakes are washed with the solvent to purify the wax from the oil. Cakes are washed in the rotary filter with the solvent to purify the wax from oil, and the solvent is recovered in wax or de-waxed oil in a distillation column. This is the description of this previous diagram, simplified de-waxing process diagram. So about 85% of the de-waxing installation use ketones as a solvent. 85% of the de-waxing installation uses ketone as a solvent, and other 15% use propane. So 85% used ketone as a solvent and 15% use as propane. So the comparative advantage and disadvantage of this process are, when we use the propane, so propane is readily available, less expensive and easier to recover. Okay, so what are the propane having the advantage and disadvantages? So it is readily available, less expensive and easier to recover, and direct chilling can be accomplished by vaporization of the solvent, thus reducing the capital and maintenance cost. Okay. Next is, high filtration rates can be obtained because of its low viscosity at low temperature. High filtration rates can be obtained because of having low viscosity at very low temperature, and rejects asphaltenes and resins in the feed. Okay. So, and rejects the heavier part, the asphaltenes and the resins in the feed. Large difference between the filtration temperature and the pour point of finished oils. Okay. So this propane is used when the large difference between the filtration temperatures and the pour point of finished oil, which is 15 to 25 degrees centigrade. And whenever we are using this propane, it requires use of a de-waxing aid. Okay, it requires the use of a de-waxing aid. Now the ketone. When 85% of the de-waxing installation use this ketone as a solvent. Now, ketone has a small difference between the filtration and filtration temperature and the pour point of de-wax oil. Ketone has small difference between filtration temperature and the pour point of de-wax oil. It is 5 to 10 degrees centigrade. But we have seen that the propane has this difference 15 to 25 degrees centigrade. Ketone has only difference between the filtration temperature and the pour point of the de-wax oil is 5 to 10, but the propane has 15 to 25 degrees centigrade. And why this for? This lowers pour point capability. So having this small difference between those temperatures, so it has lower pour point capability and greater recovery of heat by heat exchange and lower refrigeration requirement. Okay, and first chilling rate can be done, and shock chilling can be used to improve process operations, and good filtration rates, but lower than for propane. Okay, good filtration rate can be done, but it is lower than for propane. Now means whenever we use that ketone as a de-waxing process, So this solvent is added to the solvent extracted oil feed and mixture is chilled in a series of scraper, surface exchanger and the chillers. So additional solvent is added to the feed to maintain sufficient liquid for easy handling. So additional solvent, we can see also here, so additional solvent we are using with the feed for easy handling as the temperature is decreased and wax crystallize from the solution. So additional solvent is added to the feed to maintain sufficient liquid for easy handling as the temperature is decreased and the wax crystallizes from the solution. So cold filtrate means after this chilling, after this chilling operations, the cold filtrate means after this chilling operation, whatever the product is goes to the rotary filter. So from this rotary filter, the cold filtrate is used as the heat exchange medium. The cold filtrate here from the rotary filter, the cold filtrate is used as the heat exchange medium in the exchangers and a refrigerant system. Okay, in this heat exchangers and also in a refrigerant system. Now the cold slurry is fed to the rotary filter for removal of the crystalline wax, for removal of the crystalline wax. So cold slurry is used to the rotary filter for removal of crystalline wax. Then the filter cake is washed with cold solvent and an inert gas blanket with slight positive pressure, which is maintained on the filters and which is used to blow back or the wax cake from the filter cloth and release it before it reaches the filter medium scraper nib. Okay, here the solvent is recovered. Here the solvent is recovered from the filter and the wax by heating two-stage flashing followed by steam stripping process. Okay, so similar will be done for the propane dewaxing also. Then this dewaxing process may be affected by which parameters? Dewaxing process may be affected by the nature of the feedstocks, because if the feedstocks is having more paraffinic compounds, it has a different treatment. If dewaxing means if the feedstocks having a very high viscosity, it has some different treatment. So nature of feedstock is very important for the solvent dewaxing process and the type of solvent. Okay, and what are the feedstocks, and based on your feedstock, what are the properties you have in that feedstocks, based on that you have to choose your solvent. And then the solvent to feed ratio, which is very important for the dewaxing process, and then the chilling temperature, at which temperature the waxy compounds will crystallize, the chilling temperature, then the filtration process, okay, which uses the filtrates and the washing, etc. And in this filtration process, what are the types of filtrates which is used in the solvent extraction process? These are the few examples where the types of aids is used for the different types of the material, such as for microcrystalline wax, the filter aids is used as N alkylated naphthalene polymers. Okay, for microcrystalline waxes, the filtration aid is used as the normal alkylated naphthalene polymers, and for proprietary polymers, filtrate is used in alkyl polymer acrylates, and for aromatic extracts, the filtrate is used in alkyl polyaromatics, and for the vacuum residue, as a filter aids is used as asphaltenes. Okay, so these are the different filtrate is used for the solvent dewaxing process for the different materials. Okay, So as we see that the process which is affected in the dewaxing process, first one is the nature of the feedstocks, type of solvent, solvent to feed ratio, chilling temperature, filtration process, solvent recovery method, and the final desired pour point. Okay, then the final desired pour point, because we improve the cloud point as well as the pour point by the solvent dewaxing process. Next, after the solvent dewaxing, solvent extraction, solvent dewaxing process, another important treatment process, which is clay treatment process, which is clay treatment process. Okay, so this clay treatment process, it is an adsorption process which is used to remove the colored compounds, organic acids, and oxidizable hydrocarbons. So this clay treatment is nothing but a adsorption process which is used to adsorb or to remove the colored compounds and the organic compounds and the oxidizable hydrocarbons which is present in the product and which is not required in the product. So organic nitrogen compounds importantly affect the color and color stability oil. Organic nitrogen compounds importantly affect the color and color stability oil. So this clay treatment may either be carried out by contact process or the mixing process. Second, percolation techniques such as flow through a packed particle bed or the adsorbent bed. Okay, so two types of clay treatment process has been carried out. One is contact process or the mixing process, and the second one is percolation technique such as flow through a packed particle or the adsorbent bed. So this is the one schematic for the clay treatment contact process, where we can see that the feed is charged, then it is through a heater as a foam. It goes to the spray tank, and then the feed is also charged through the pump, and again it goes to this section. This as a spray, it enters, and this spray and the foam, which increase the surface area and provide the good mass transfer as well as the heat transfer. Then the lighter will vent out, and whatever the heavier one, it again goes back to the foam tank. Okay, and the second part of this feed, which is charged to the foam tank, the part of that liquid also means that part of the liquid is also goes back to the foam tank, and means after this means here whatever the heavier ones from the foam tank, it again goes to with the water after hot oil cooler, it again goes to the surge tank, where the heavier one is treated, means where this feed is treated with the flue gas. So after treating, the heavier one goes to the Sweetland filters, where the spent clay is removed out, and the bottom, the heavier part, is sent to the bloater press, where the spent clay fines are separated out, and the bottom part, then again with the water heat exchange, it goes as a clay treated oil. Okay, so we can get this clay treated oil. So what are the things after feed, means the feed is charged in the foam tank, and in this foam tank with some part of this the heavier feed, which is goes through a heater and enters in this foam tank, and the lighter one will vent out, and the heavier one again goes to the with the water and the hot will through the hot oil cooler, and then it goes to the surge tank with the flue gas, and then whatever the heavier one coming out from the surge tank, it goes to the sweatland filters where the spent clay is removed out, and from the bottom of these sweatland filters, whatever the heavier ones are present, it goes to the bloater press where the spent clay fines are separated out, and then goes through the heat exchanger, which finally we from where finally we get the clay treated oil. And here we can see for the clay surge tank, means whatever the slurry is going, clay and water slurry is entered into this clay surge tank with the flue gas, and the lighter will the vent out, and this product pump to the this foam tank also with the feed. Okay, so in this contact process we will see the oil and clay are mixed, heated, okay, mixed and heated and agitated and filtered. So the operation is going on here in the clay treatment process: mixing, heating, agitation and filtration. Okay, mixing, heating, agitation and filtration. So the process is affected by clay type, clay quantity and treating temperature. So this process is affected the type of clay and what is the clay quantity present and what are the treating temperature. So the previous one is the contact process for the clay treatment, and this is the percolation method for the clay treatment process. Okay, here what are the things here? The naphtha, steam and feed which is enters in the filtration medium. Okay, and whatever the used of the after using it, it then goes to the spent clay elevator. Okay, then it again sent to the rotary kiln where the high temperature is going on in this rotary kiln, where from this kiln it again goes to the hot clay elevator, where from that the cooling is done in this cooler, and after this cooler it is then regenerated in the clay elevator, and then this regenerated clay is going back to this filtration unit. Okay, and whatever the product is coming at the bottom of this filter medium, it again goes through a pump to the finished loop as a finished loop, and another part is used to naphtha and oil recovery process. So one is used as a finished loop and another part is used as a naphtha and oil recovery process. Okay, so in this percolation method we use the elevator, spent clay elevator, hot clay elevator and the regenerated clay elevator, and in between this the spent clay elevator and the hot clay elevator there is a rotary kiln to raise the temperature and the product which again goes to this hot clay elevator where some clay is cooled, this clay is cooled and then it again regenerated in the clay elevator. After regenerated it, it again sent to the filter unit. So this percolation adsorption cycle where the charge filter with activated adsorbent, in this percolation adsorption treatment in the clay treatment process, so we can see here that there is a charge of the filter with activated adsorbent, then charge the filter with feedstocks, then soak the filter which is close enough for a period of time for the soaking purpose of that filter, then percolate oil to product specification, then drain oil from the filter, and then wash again the filter with the solvent and steam the filter to remove the solvent and the oil, and dump steam clay for regeneration. Okay, so first is a charge filter with activated adsorbent, then the charge filter with the feedstock, then soaking of the filtration for a some period of time to provide a good residence time, and then percolate oil to product specification, then drain oil from the filter, and then wash the filter with the solvent, then steam the filter to remove the solvent and oil, and then again dump the steam clay for regeneration and again use to the filtration unit. So this clay treatments, clays, there are two common types of clays are used. One is atapulugas and one is porosil. Okay, so two common types of clays are used. One is atapulugas and another is porosil. So this atapulugas is a hydrous magnesium aluminium silicate, which is also called the Fuller's earth, while porosil is primarily hydrated aluminium oxide, which is also called the bauxite. Okay, so now both these clays are activated by heat treatment. Both these clays are activated by heat treatment, and this atapulugas clay is tempered at 260 to 420 degrees centigrade with a residence time of 15 to 30 minutes. Okay, so this atapulugas clay is tempered at 260 to 470 degrees centigrade with residence time of 15 to 30 minutes, and the porosil clay is tempered for 15 to 30 minutes, the same residence time having for this porosil clay, but the temperature is 371 to 482 degrees centigrade. And this paint clay disposal issues may be one of the major reasons for replacing the clay treatment. Okay, this paint clay disposal issue may be one of the major reasons for replacing the clay treatment with an increasingly popular hydrogen treatment or the hydro finishing treatment. So whatever the paint clay is disposed, it has many environmental issues. So for replace this clay treatment with an increasingly popular hydrogen treatment is done, which is also called the hydro finishing process. So we can see that finishing of this clay contact process. So we can see that many older lube oil processing plants use contacting of this de-waxed oil with activated clays, which is at elevated temperature, to improve the stability of the finished oil for the better engine service. And the polar compounds means aromatic and sulfur and nitrogen containing molecules. Polar compounds means the aromatic, sulfur and nitrogen containing molecules. So these polar compounds are adsorbed on the clay and removed by filtration. So spent clay disposal and the operating restriction have generally caused the clay treating, which is replaced by the hydro finishing process. As the polar compounds are adsorbed on the clay, and these polar compounds are nothing but the aromatic, sulfur and the nitrogen compounds, which are having some restriction in the environmental. So these as these are having issues, so this paint clay disposal and the operating restrictions have generally caused the clay treating to be replaced by hydro finishing or the hydro treatment process. So what is this hydro treating or the de-waxing of this lube oil? So hydro finishing or the hydro treating of the de-waxed lube oil stocks is needed to remove the chemically active compounds. Okay, so this hydro treating or the hydro finishing of de-waxed lube oil stocks is needed to remove chemically active compounds that affect the color and the color stability of that lube oils. Okay, so the organic nitrogen compounds which is present that in that clay treatment process, where the organic nitrogen compounds seriously affect the color and the color stability of oils, and their removal is a major requirement of these operations means for the hydrofin by using this hydrofinishing or the hydrotreatment process. Okay, so usually that finished oil yields are appropriately 98% of dewaxed oil feed by the hydrofinishing or the hydrotreating of dewaxed lube oil. Okay, so thank you students for this class.